Hi, I'm Mark Rossano, founder and CEO of C6 Capital Holdings, coming to you from Primary Vision Network. Now, today, I did go home and change. This is we filmed them at the same time, so I don't want anyone to be concerned that I slept at the office. But today, we're going to really focus in on, and we wanted to break up the shows to really hone in on OPEC production, non-OPEC production, what's happening in global refining margins, and then a big geopolitical update in terms of where some interesting developments are really occurring. You know, obviously we have to start in where everyone cares the most in terms of what's going to happen going into August, and it's going to be OPEC production. And we're going to break it up a little bit and focus on some countries that really matter the most. And that's why we're going to look at OPEC production first. So we already have commentary out of the UAE that they're going to bring on 300,000 barrels. So you can see based on the capacity on the right, which is what is quoted to be spare capacity, you know, they have about 1 million barrels. So to see 300,000 come on is not unheard of. And it's very well within their margin of error to bring that back. The bigger issue has been Venezuela. Venezuela has reached all-time lows in terms of where production is. They had a fire at one of their refiners. You know, things are just evolving quickly in Venezuela. So that's something that's going to remain a huge weight over the Venezuelan production going forward. And at the same time, we have Libya, where there continues to be strife at the port in terms of, you know, who's coming in, who's coming out, what's the blockade happening. So a Suezmax was blocked from coming in just as recently as today, which is going to continue to be an issue. So while we don't think you're going to see a huge drop off in production or exports, we think that using 100 to 110 is a very safe assumption going into the rest of July and into August. Now, Iran is interesting, and that's something that we're going to talk a little bit more about later on, and just to hone in on some more timing in terms of what that looks like. But Iran is going to see relatively stable, but could see production really come off as storage starts to fill up. You know, the bigger question is going to be Saudi Arabia, which, you know, has already talked about bringing back an additional million barrels for July. And then, you know, as the OPEC plus agreement starts to adjust in August, you know, just based on commentary so far, we'll see an additional production increase specifically out of the GCC or the Gulf Cooperation Council. Some interesting tidbits in terms of where demand is. You know, the Congo is now, given it's 300,000 barrels a day, but they're having trouble placing their crude. And the oil goes specifically to China. And China is going to be a bigger problem as we go through the remainder of the summer and into the fall, where we typically see prices come down just because demand wanes going into the shoulder season. That's going to be interesting. And we'll talk about the Chinese demand a little bit more in a few minutes. So when we look at crude production, we're going to look at just the loading schedules. Now, the reason why we're going to look at these specific loading schedules is Norway is actually increasing. So it's something to talk about when we're looking at non-OPEC production. Norway loadings are actually going up, even though they're supposed to kind of stay relatively flat. And it's, again, year over year, it's increasing. So even as you've seen OPEC come down, Norway has come back up, Brazil has come up, which is really helping to offset some of these different loadings. You know, Nigeria is, again, remaining non-compliant. I don't see that changing just given their economic backdrop. But they just had an explosion at an onshore oil platform that unfortunately resulted in deaths. It sold through Shell, and it's something to just watch. Like, I don't think it'll be impactful in terms of the loadings that we're seeing here, because there's enough in storage and enough in floating storage to make up that difference. But again, was it terrorism? Is it something that was just an error? You know, what does it take to fix? That's something that is going to kind of keep Nigerian production relatively flat. But again, these are the issues that are starting to arise. The other one is Angola. So Angola has come closer to compliance, but they've come out and said, look, we're struggling across the board because we have production down, oil prices down, and we're taking IMF money. It's just Angola is falling under the same economic weight that we've seen from Iraq, Nigeria. Again, slightly better, you know, backdrop just in terms of where they sit, and their relationship with China is a bit stronger, which, you know, in theory should provide some support. But in this given time, it won't do much, just given China has also tapped out the amount that they can actually stimulate, at least within their country, which we'll go into a bit more depth. And then Russia, you know, Russia is a huge component of how this OPEC plus deal has somewhat worked. And you see that, you know, in August, they're starting to get some loadings. They finally come into compliance this for July. You know, that's something that we think is going to be relatively stable through July at least. But again, we've also seen an increase in refined product production. We've seen some of the refiners come back online, which even though they may be exporting less oil, they're exporting more product, especially above typical seasonal norms, which is going to be supportive of their, you know, industry for the most part. But it's going to weigh on refined product throughput, because is it cheaper for me to purchase the finished product from Russia or to make it myself, given where margins are, and margins are negative. So given what deals they can get, it might make sense. So it's going to, again, weigh on that oil demand. You know, even though we've seen supply come down, that demand is going to remain a problem. And you know, we talked about Brazil, and it's important to really appreciate, well, what does that mean? And you're seeing the increase from 2019 that has been relatively sticky, and it's starting to go up. And the reason why it's going to start going up is because two specific platforms in the pre-salt production had to come offline because of COVID infections on those platforms. Those are now back. Now, that was about 9% of production. So we can see that we're at about, you know, 2.9 through May, which means that in June, we're going to see an increase of about 9%. But again, it's going to give and take on different levels. So to see about 3 million to 3.1 million barrels a day is very likely. Now, the reason why that's a problem is because China is actually reducing their purchases of Brazilian crude. Now, typically, China purchases about 60% of Brazilian flow, which is now going to be reduced because teapots are cutting refinery rates by about another 2%. You have a ton of storage available. And when you look at what teapots have said, which are the independents, as well as the SOEs, they're full on refined product storage. They're seeing a slowdown in refined product demand. They're exporting more refined product, and they have a huge amount of floating oil storage to work through. So this Brazilian crude is going to get stuck, and it will most likely, specifically on the Lula and those medium sweets, will find a home in the U.S., which will be positive for the Gulf of Mexico, but it's going to hurt total U.S. Oil demand going into the Gulf of Mexico. And by the Gulf of Mexico, I mean PADD 3 and the refiners there. So there's going to be some, you know, more pain to be had in terms of how are the Gulf of Mexico refiners going to get that feedstock. And I think a lot of that Brazilian flow could come back up north. And now, speaking about our Latin friends, you know, it's important to really look at Mexico. Now, Mexican production has continued to come off. And the reason why this is a problem, outside of the inherent, you know, just economic problems that they're experiencing across the board, the fact that Pemex actually has the most debt in the world for an energy company. So they have about $105 billion in debt already, making them the biggest borrower, and they're borrowing more. Now, not only are they borrowing more, they're also going to their suppliers and saying, we can't pay you this year. You know, you're going to take an IOU, and we're going to hopefully pay you 180 days out. So this is going to be a problem. Like, do I work with them? Do I trust that I'm going to get paid? And this is why you've seen production really come off. And again, it's not something that's going to increase. So while Brazil's going up, Mexico's coming down, and you're going to get that little bit of that offset. Now, this would be a net positive if China was purchasing on their normal rates. You know, things weren't so oversupplied. But again, this is something that's going to be relatively positive for oil pricing within the Gulf of Mexico. And it's something to be considered, because it's going to take a lot of money to stem this decline, because a lot of the current wells are in terminal decline, which means that no matter what you can really do, you're going to see a marked step up in those decline rates without new wells, without new tiebacks, which again make money in this current environment, especially at the tieback level. It's just a matter of who's willing to take the risk and work with Pemex, given these debt loads and these IOUs not being paid. Now, we talk about Asia, and it's important to appreciate what's happening in Asia. And here, we finally had some of that oil storage coming down a little bit, but it was really driven based on India, South Korea, and Japan, not China. China has continued to see an increase in their floating storage, and that's one of the reasons why those teapots and SOEs, which just means state-operated enterprises, are starting to really roll back those utilization rates through the summer, and they purchased crude assuming they were gonna stay at those rates, which means that this crude in storage, both onshore and offshore, is gonna bleed into not only July, August, because they've already made their purchases, but September and October, as these headwinds continue to reside throughout their whole economy. And now, again, global storage has come down. It was really driven based on the declines, a little bit of a decline in Asia, a decline in the US and Europe, but we had big increases in the Middle East and in West Africa. And that's why we're starting to see some of these builds. And again, that's why we look at West Africa and the Middle East, because they're talking about these cuts. But what is really driving those cuts? Is it because they have so much on water that they can just push it into the market? And these are things that we're going back and forth with. And that's why we continue to be bearish on demand. Even as supply has come down, we're still not seeing that offset demand to help support that. And it's really because their key buyers, the refiners, don't make money. So it's really hard to see them want to increase their throughput, which will be a headwind, you know, as we go through the remainder of driving season and into the shoulder season for refining. You know, we've talked about what's happened with supply and where supply has come off, but we really need to consider what's happening in the demand world and how, you know, who's a bigger buyer of crude than refiners. And we continue to see the degradation in margin. And that's really starting to hinder the way people are consuming, the way, you know, the refined products are really flowing. So one of the big things that we've seen was Asian fuel or Asian distillate really going into Europe. And that started to slow a little bit, which is good. And it's really slowed because we have a new reopenings, we have economies coming back, which is going to absorb some of that distillate that was being pushed into the market. But we're still seeing, a kind of a normal move, you know, back to normal in terms of where we should be in both July and August. Now, it's a huge step down from May and June, which, again, there was just more product to go, which will help be, which will really be supportive of U.S. distillate exports into the market, specifically going into Europe. Now, this may look great, and you might say, okay, well, it's just because, you know, the economies are booming, things are getting better, but there's always a disconnect between when does a refiner come on in India, and then how much product, you know, that was slated for export now needs to be consumed locally. You know, we've seen those growing pains already happen, and you're starting to see exports increase a little bit. And the exports are increasing, but they're really not heading to Europe. They're heading to other areas within Asia or within Africa, which is going to kind of, again, change the dynamics, because Africa has been a normal stopping ground for European product, and that's going to continue to see weight, which is going to push more Europe product into Latin America, hurting U.S. product going into LATAM. And I know this all sounds great and fun and it sounds confusing, but that's really how things are changing. China increasing their refinery throughput, India building new refiners, Middle East building new refiners, and completing previously sanctioned ones is just changing the flow. Like, this is something that has never really been seen before on these levels. And we're going to see forced shutdowns in Europe in terms of permanent shutdowns. We're going to see reduced utilization rates in areas that typically see 95-97%, specifically in the US, where maybe the new normal for the next, you know, year or 2 years is going to be 87-90% as we have this competition. You know, Shell's looking to sell their refinery in Louisiana. You have these majors, BP's looking to possibly sell Whiting in the MidCon. You know, you're getting these shift in assets, and it's going to be really interesting to see how this all kind of plays out. And the, you know, when we talk about Europe, and the reason why, you know, Europe is an interesting component is because you continue to see the GDP contraction. You know, again, these are estimates. Estimates go up, they go down. But the PMIs, while they've recovered, and we've talked about France, it's still contracting, and you're still going to see the reduced distillate demand that's just going to be driven based on less exports, less imports, and then less just stuff being built and manufactured onshore. And that's really going to also weigh on that distillate demand. So that's why, while the distillate imports are coming down, you're getting, well, there's a little bit more demand in Asia, but there's also a little less demand in Europe. And the European demand year over year still remains down about 15% for disti, which we think is going to kind of carry through the remainder of the year. And that's when we turn to Singapore. And Singapore remains at, you know, seasonally adjusted all-time highs. And again, it comes down to, well, we need to make more room for stuff. So when we talk about, you know, a lot of these exports coming out, you have to make room for, you know, floating storage. You have to make room for storage on land, because you need your refiners to get back to operational. You can't just, you know, statically go from 40 to 80. Like, you need to go up in a step function, because you need to make sure the system is working, the catalysts are right, you know, the everything is acting the way it should, and you have a place to put this product. So that's why you're getting these adjustments, which is going to be a net positive in terms of, you know, the product on the coast, which has already kind of been pushed into the market, been pulled onshore, specifically in Europe and Africa. But you're still seeing the oversupply on the products level. And Singapore is going to be a place to watch to see how much are we really whittling through. And when you can't talk about refining and refined products without really talking about OSPs and the official selling price. And it's always fun to see how Saudi Arabia tries to spin what they're doing. And, you know, they're trying to say, oh, well, we only increased the official selling price by a dollar. It's like, okay, well, I wasn't making money before and I'm not making money now, so thank you. Like, what did you really do for me? And if you look at it on a seasonal level, they, you know, they've increased it right around the 5-year average, which again is a starting point. You'll have benefits, you'll have discounts that'll come in to kind of take you at that level. But we're not seeing anything aggressive on the margin level. You know, we've seen margins go from -$3 to -$1. And by increasing the OSP by another dollar, you're just going to take more margin and more benefits away from the refiner, which is going to incentivize them to maintain current throughput. But they're already incentivized to do that. So you can kind of go both ways. It's like, well, Saudi Arabia knows you can't buy, so let's just make the money that we can. But the refiner is sitting there and saying, I have low demand. I have to sell my product at an elevated price, which is going to hurt demand further based on the pressure in the global economy. And you are raising your prices. So you're kind of seeing why these throughputs, we really don't see them increasing, which is why we don't really see demand really getting that much better for oil, at least through the end of the year. And just to look at, again, where does Saudi Arabia sit? And you can see that across the board, it was anywhere from a dollar to 30 cents, depending on where we were looking between August and July. But you've had a relatively stable move. You had some declines in the Mediterranean, but things have kind of been relatively stable. But it's interesting that you see the cut into the Med, because this is also a place where there are they trying to compete with Russia on Urals? Because if you remember from last week, we talked about how Urals were trading at a 350 premium to dated Brent. And now Saudi Arabia is coming in with, oh, well, we're going to come in with a discount, or we're going to take some money back. So it could be some competition for, you know, let's see if we can displace some Urals, protect some market share. So this is something that'll be interesting. But overall, it was an increase across the board, which is, again, going to weigh against refinery throughput, just because the margin isn't there. And, you know, we keep talking about it, but let's just show some pictures and just show some numbers. And again, like, this is oil analytics data. I can change the FCC, it's just fluid catalytic cracker. I can change that to hydroskimmer. I can change that to, catalytics. I can do any process I can possibly think of. It's not going to change the fact that they're all negative. And it waffles from sometimes it's not as negative, sometimes it's more negative, and this is the pressure. And that's why when we look at the med, specifically the Urals, in that top piece, you can see that the margin is down negative $3.16. Now, again, this is a calculated number, but you have to appreciate, well, this is what Saudi Arabia is seeing. So maybe if we cut the prices, we can help bring some of that market share back to us. And this is something that's going to have to be watched, because we think this is going to remain. And this is why you're going to see these refiners trying to be very clever with, or, well, how do we try to protect margin and protect storage, because storage costs money. And this is going to be something that's going to weigh on overall pricing. You know, before we talked about why Iran was really going to be interesting, and the reason why Iran production is interesting is just based on onshore crude oil storage and offshore crude oil storage. It continues to rise. You know, we had more pressure from the U.S. as Iran tried to send more product to Venezuela. You're seeing some shifts in the market in terms of, well, what's happening in Iran? How are people really viewing it? And if you think about how demand has fallen off, people aren't willing to take the risk. And by people, I mean countries, SOEs, companies, in terms of, you know, is it worth taking Iranian crude in terms of backing for insurance, because I can't get it because most insurance, floating insurance, is sold in U.S. dollars, which means I need U.S. banks. You know, so you're starting to see these different competitions. And some interesting quotes from Kepler was that total onshore crude stock surged to 54 million barrels in April from 15 million in January, which is big. And then it swelled further to 63 million. Now, this is FG&E Energy. But now if we look at Kepler, they're saying 66 million. So you're seeing we're right around that number. But at the same time, onshore storage capacity is filled to about 85%. So you can't, again, you can't produce oil if you don't have a place to put it. And you have an increase in instability within Iran itself. So they had a nuclear facility where they were building advanced centrifuges blow up. And you might think, well, it was a bad actor. There's a lot of reasons why something like that would be potential right now. They've lost and continue to lose local support. So if you have Israel, U.S., you know, Western Europe, or some amalgamation of those entities, can get someone locally to do that if it's going to move them closer to getting rid of U.S. sanctions, getting rid of U.N. sanctions, and starting to normalize things a bit. So this is something to watch, because I think that, you know, that is a very protected facility that was able to be infiltrated and exploded, which is not something that happens all the time. And we now have pretty good information that it has now been Iran's ability to enrich uranium has been set back by about a year. So you kind of get an idea of why this is so important, and it may try to be defended. The problem is Iran, based on onshore crude, offshore crude, they're not selling oil. And that's going to continue to hinder their economic progress as sanctions remain well through the end of the year. And then it's just going to be a very tough time for them going into this downturn, because pricing just remains terrible for their crude anyway, because they have to sell at a discount just to get someone to buy it. So now, just to round out the geopolitics, you know, we have to look at India and China. You know, there's been these movements in terms of, oh, things have gotten better, things have gotten worse. Well, this is a gentleman that I follow on Twitter, and it's something that he created using, you know, available satellite imagery. And things haven't changed. You know, things have only continued to remain problematic. And you're starting to see supply lines get reinforced. You're seeing some new camps get built around very, very important constructs in that supply line. And these are just showing the reinforcements, where some people have said, where China said, oh, we're pulling back. And India said, no, you're not pulling back. And the satellite imagery does support India saying, no, you aren't pulling back. You're actually reinforcing in key areas. Now, these are things to continue to watch, especially as the rhetoric gets worse. You know, the U.S. has talked about banning TikTok in the U.S. You're getting a tit for tat on the economic level in terms of going back and forth of trying to impact and influence some political moves within China, which obviously they will never like. And this is going to be something as a flashpoint to focus on, especially as you have Pakistani troops that have been moving in on their side of the line. And you're going to start to see this heat up. And especially, you know, things typically slow down in winter for obvious reasons. You're already in the Himalayas, which is continuous winter. But a lot of these areas also have their own snowfall, which also hinders. So you typically have things surge in the spring, kind of, you know, calm down or normalize, and then surge again before we go into the winter to kind of get those lines that are going to be held through the winter season. So these are components that are going to have to be looked at. Now, thanks again for watching. You know, tomorrow, we're going to come to you with the primary vision frac spread count and just looking at, you know, what do we think U.S. production is going to do, you know, through July and into August. So it'll be a little bit shorter, give you a nice reprieve from our nice long in-depth dives. And, you know, next week we'll come to you with some great color again on the EIA frac spread count and just some geopolitical updates and a bigger focus on NGLs and chemicals. So thanks again for watching. I'm Mark Rossano, founder and CEO of C6 Capital Holdings, coming to you from Primary Vision Network. Thanks again.